Dear brethren, have you ever made a mistake that you would just so much want to go back and correct? If you just had a chance to go back and to make that right. Well, our first reading by Sister Sarah Easton talks about this land of beginning again, which we think is a really good metaphor for that glorious reign in the kingdom, the mediatorial phase.
The land of beginning again. I wish that there were some wonderful place called the land of beginning again, where all our mistakes and all our heartaches and all of our poor selfish grief could be dropped like a shabby old coat at the door and never put on again. I wish we could come on at all, unaware, like the hunter who finds a lost trail. And I wish that the one whom our blindness had done the greatest injustice of all could be at the gates like an old friend that waits for the comrade he's gladdest to hail. We would find all the things we intended to do but forgot and remembered too late. Little praises unspoken, little promises broken, and all of the 1,001 little duties neglected that might have perfected the day for one less fortunate. It wouldn't be possible not to be kind in the land of beginning again. And the ones we misjudged and the ones we grudged the moments of victory here would find in the grasp of our loving hand clasp more than penitent lips could explain. For what had been hardest we'd know had been best. What had seemed lost would be gained. For there isn't a sting that will not take wing when we faced it and laughed it away. And I think that the laughter is most what we're after in the land of beginning again. So I wish that there were some wonderful place called the land of beginning again, where all our mistakes and all our heartaches and all of our poor selfish grief could be dropped like a shabby old coat at the door and never be put on again.
And dear friends, you know, for mankind, there is this land of beginning again. And you've probably experienced in the world, as I have, that most of what individuals want is they just want a fair chance in this world. So many people I've worked with, they just want things to be fair. So our next reading, this is from Psalm 94. This is Sister Vicki Flood reading for us. But this is the question the world of mankind really ponders right now.
How long shall the wicked triumph? O Lord God, to whom vengeance belongs, O God, to whom vengeance belongs, show yourself. Lift yourself up, you judge of the earth. Render a reward to the proud. Lord, how long shall the wicked, how long shall the wicked triumph? How long shall they utter and speak hard things? And all the workers of iniquity boast in themselves. They break in pieces your people, O Lord, and afflict your heritage. They slay the widow and the stranger, and murder the fatherless. Yet they say, the Lord shall not see, nor does the God of Jacob understand. Understand, you senseless among the people, and you fools. When will you be wise? He who planted the ear, shall he not hear? He who formed the eye, shall he not see? Psalms 94, 1 through 9.
And of course, this is answered in Exodus 3. We'll have Sister Martha Moody read this.
Jehovah sees and hears. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good and large land, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you unto Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Exodus 3, verses 7 and 8.
Dear friends, just think what this means. We know Israel in type pictures the world of mankind. The Lord's eyes are in every place, beholding the good and the evil. He sees exactly what mankind experiences, and he sympathizes, brethren. He understands. So he does see and hear. And brethren, you know, so many people today have the attitude in the song you're going to hear next. Though this one we're not inviting you to sing, but this was a Grammy Award-winning song from 1983. You might be familiar with it, but I think it really represents the sentiments of people today. It's called A Little Good News.
This morning, the kids had the morning news show on. Brian Campbell was talking about the fighting in Lebanon. Some senator was squawking about the bad economy. It's gonna get worse, you see. Need a change of policy. There's a local paper rolled up in a rubber band. One more sad story's one more than I can stand. Just once, how I'd like to see the headline say, not much to print today, can't find nothing better to say. The news will be the same. Somebody takes a hostage, somebody steals a plane. How I want to hear the anchor man talk about a county fair and how we cleaned up the air, how everybody learned to care.
Now, friends, as you looked at that, you probably recognize that what mankind wants is all the bad things to stop happening. It's interesting, they don't think about all the goodness and the blessings that lie ahead. And this is what we see in the desire of all nations. And here we'd like to ask Sister Nancy Mahachik, or have Sister Nancy, to read this from Haggai.
The desire of all nations. Haggai 2. Verses 6 to 9. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once, it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, saith the Lord of hosts.
Did you notice how many times that the Lord of hosts was referenced there? And if you think of all the trouble on the earth today, and yet the Lord of hosts is on the church's side, he's on the people's side. And brethren, he has had his plan from eternity past. We'd like to have Brother Nishan now share from Psalm 90 about his eternal purpose.
A prayer of Moses, the man of God. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turn man to destruction and say, return, you sons of Adam. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Psalms 90, 1 through 4.
Brother, you notice this is probably the shortest explanation of the plan you could have, turning man to destruction and saying, return, you sons of Adam. Not just to return to be judged finally to heaven or hell, but to be judged back to the place that Father Adam had. And dear brethren, it's pretty amazing that our Savior, the desire of all nations, should be so misunderstood in this time. But his life will be such a plain testimony to mankind, as we find in our next reading from Isaiah 52. And this is from Sister Sandy Cothran.
We hid our eyes. Behold, my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. Just as many were astonished at you, even my people were astonished. So his appearance was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Thus he will sprinkle many nations. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. For what had not been told them, they will see, and what they had not heard, they will understand. Isaiah 52, verses 13 through 15.
We find a description in Isaiah 11 of the righteousness that mankind really seeks. And brethren, we have such a wonderful lesson that he who died for mankind is the one who is the righteous judge. Mankind won't have to fear the tyranny, we would say, of the kingdom. It'll be an autocratic rule, but it will be led by one who died for them. And here's the description, Sister Tina King reading for us.
The righteous judge, and the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. Isaiah 11, 2-4.
So in this life, it doesn't matter how eloquent a speaker someone is, they won't be able to talk their way out of their sins. Doesn't matter how pretty they are, they won't be able to bat their eyelids and get their way out of a correction. But it will be a righteous judgment that most of mankind longs for, dear brethren. And of course, this breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. You can see the truth there, taking away wickedness from mankind. Yes, there will be some incorrigible, but most of mankind will reform, and that's how most of the wicked will be destroyed. Well, brethren, there's a beautiful prayer, we believe, at the end of Psalm 90 that we asked Sister Gloria Carpenter to read for you, and this has to do with making mankind glad in the kingdom.
Return, O Lord, how long, and you may have compassion concerning your servants. O satisfy us early with your mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days in which you have afflicted us, and the years in which we have seen evil. Let your work appear unto your servants, and your glory unto their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish you the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands establish it. Psalms 90:13-17.
Brethren, we find this very touching, that mankind will pray again to be in God's image in the kingdom. They'll want that place that Adam had. Well, brethren, we're going to sing a hymn now. Again, we invite you all. And this is a familiar hymn, but the British Bible students actually have different words in their verses. And so I've picked two verses from that hymnal that are really beautiful, and then two of ours, and put them together. So you have to really pay attention to the words if you like this hymn. Brethren, the world of mankind in that kingdom will have such help. They will have the examples of the church that has gone before, and they'll have perfect human examples. We have the two phases of the kingdom, this out of Zion the law going forth, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. You know, no one will be able to say in the kingdom, this is too hard, or I can't do it, with these examples they have before them. And brethren, it's kind of remarkable. We spoke with some individuals in Israel, Jewish people, who believe this scripture, that they believe that their holy men of old will be restored to them. And we'd like to have Brother Anthony Coffey to read this for us.
I will restore your judges and your counselors. The Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, said unto his natural people, I will turn my hand upon you, and thoroughly purge away your dross, and take away your alloy. I will restore your judges as at the first, and your counselors as at the beginning. Afterward you shall be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city. Zion shall be redeemed with justice, and her penitence with righteousness. Isaiah 1:24-27. Jesus himself spoke of the nation of Israel, seeing their fathers and prophets in the kingdom. Luke 13:28-29. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and yourselves thrust out. They will come from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God.
Brother, you think about that. Mankind from all across the globe, the east, the west, the north, south, they will all come to learn from these ancient worthies. And brethren, the appearance of the ancient worthies is a sign of the beginning of the glorious reign, as we have in Isaiah 32. We'd like to have a little more told us about the work of these kings and princes. We have Sister Debbie Moss with the next reading.
Kings and princes, see, a king will reign in righteousness, and princes will rule with justice. Each will be like a hiding place from the wind, a covert from the tempest, like streams of water in a dry place, like the shade of a great rock in a weary land. Then the eyes of those who have sight will not be closed, and the ears of those who have hearing will listen. The minds of the rash will have good judgment, and the tongues of stammerers will speak readily and distinctly. A fool will no longer be called noble, nor a villain said to be honorable.
This reading really helps us understand just how much society will be revolutionized by the kingdom. You know, brethren, right now we think how one sin leads to another sin. Think of in the kingdom how that'll be reversed, how one repentance and correction will lead to other repentances and corrections as each takes steps higher. We'd like to have now Brother Joseph King to comment. We understand the scripture, the first shall be last and the last first, and here is his reading on the living generation, the first.
Reprint 4499. Our thought is that the restitution blessings will begin with the generation living at the time of the inauguration of the mediator's kingdom, that it will deal first with these and bring them to a measure of recuperation before beginning with any of those who sleep in the dust of the earth. And further, that those of the sleepers who went down into death most recently will be the first to come up, while those who went down first will be the last to come up. In other words, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Our thought is that quite probably the awakenings of the world will be in response to the prayers of their friends during the millennium, and that those living at any time will be specially interested in praying for such as were their acquaintances or relatives.
And dear brethren, it's not only mankind that will be restored, but we think about the earth and just the beginnings that we see in Israel. How this land, this is from Ezekiel 36:35, this land that was desolate, and this is a picture of in the south of Israel, it's reclaimed even now. Now this is in the north, but this is an example of how productive the land of Israel has become. It is becoming like the Garden of Eden, brethren. Now dear friends, you think you had a good meal yesterday. The scriptures tell us that God has prepared a feast of fat things for mankind. Really, the truths, the encouragements from the Heavenly Father, the promises that belong to mankind. We'll have Sister Beth Robinson read this passage for us.
In this mountain, a feast of fat things, and in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. And he will destroy in this mountain the face of the covering cast over all people, and the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from off all faces, and the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off all the earth, for the Lord hath spoken it. And it shall be said in that day, lo, this is our God, we have waited for him, and he will save us. This is the Lord, we have waited for him, we will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Isaiah 25, 6 to 9.
Brother, we'd like to share the song together, Come Ye Disconsolate. Friends, this is probably the thing the poor world has the hardest time understanding right now. How can whatever experiences mankind have had, we think of the Holocaust or the Inquisition, those who went through those things, and yet the scriptures promise us that the blessings will far more than outweigh the trials of this life. We can't underestimate the healing that the kingdom will bring to mankind. Well, dear friends, in our next section, we've asked Sister Robin Heide for a reading about the regeneration. It's a very interesting word that Jesus uses in Matthew about the regeneration. It has the thought of a new birthday. Now, every person will have a new birthday, the day of their start in the way of regeneration.
What will the regeneration be like? Jesus said to the apostles, assuredly, I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Matthew 19:28. And to Israel, God says in Ezekiel 37:12, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves. In John 5:28, of the regeneration, Jesus also said, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come forth, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment.
This is a rather famous picture some of you may recognize. This is a returning soldier from the Vietnam War. You think about those who've had children go off to war and they don't know if they'll ever see them again. You think about that, brethren, then with the kingdom. You think about those whose lives were taken in the Holocaust, how they tried to find their families afterwards and how little some never found any of their families remaining. And yet here in the kingdom, brethren, this in a little way is a foretaste of getting someone back you thought was gone from you. And just you think of the joy in the human heart. Personally, I think the Lord's going to expand the capacity of the human heart to experience the greatness of the joy that he will bring to them. Well, brethren, our next reading on the resurrection is about Lazarus, and we have Sister Carol Duran for this reading.
Lazarus. Lazarus was not resurrected. He was merely awakened from the sleep of death. Resurrection would signify the complete raising up out of sin and death conditions to perfection and life conditions. The calling forth of Lazarus, therefore, is a good picture of what may be expected early in the millennial reign after the living nations shall have been to some extent enlightened and brought under the influence of the heavenly kingdom. Then all that are in their graves, order by order, class by class, generation by generation, will come forth as Lazarus did to a measure of health and a measure of strength, but not to perfection of being. By hearing the voice of the Son of Man, by obeying the same, going onward step by step, they shall emerge gradually from all the weight of the curse, from all the weaknesses and imperfections of the present dying condition, to the full life and perfection and joy of the life eternal condition at the close of the millennial age.
Brother, you know, it is the most reasonable process to have mankind do the work of coming up to perfection, of correcting not only the problems of the past. Brother, there's no other religion that teaches the responsibility man will each have for making their choices and for progressing in this way. It's really wonderful what our Father has done. Each man and woman will fully know the effects of sin, what it meant in themselves, and the process it took for them to recover. Well, brethren, there's a wonderful passage in the book of Job, and we have Brother Steve Cavanaugh to read this for us. But it's pretty amazing that so long ago in the book of Job, we find the word ransom, long before our dear Jesus gave his life.
I have found a ransom. Yea, his soul draw near unto the grave, and his life to those who bring death. If there be a messenger with him, a mediator, one of a thousand, to show unto man his uprightness, then he is gracious unto him, and says, deliver him from going down to the pit. I have found a ransom. His flesh shall be younger than a child's. He shall return to the days of his youth. He shall pray unto God, and God will be favorable unto him, and he shall see his face with joy, for God will render unto man his righteousness.
God will render unto man his righteousness. And brethren, I love the thought of when man comes back, their flesh shall be fresher than a baby's. You just think about that. It's pretty amazing. They'll return to the days of their youth. Brother, we'd like to sing together then. This may be a difficult hymn we've heard before, but Resurrection Morn is just a very touching one.
Resurrection born from the
For our next reading, we ask Sister Kathy Sandridge to read for us a portion entitled The World of Tomorrow.
The World of Tomorrow. Close your eyes a moment to misery and woe and all earth's degradations, which from sin and sorrow grow. And let your mental vision behold a perfect earth, without the stain of sin to mar the things of grander worth. No bitter thought nor unkind word will ever find a part, and only love will meet response in every kindred heart. Benevolence shall mark each act, and sickness be no more, no evidence of dread decay shall lodge at mortal's door. Where health and radiant beauty march in unsurpassed array, and inward purity shines forth as all seek to obey. And such will be perfection in a world that's freed from sin. With all earth's tears and sorrow as though they had not been. For those we've loved and cherished and laid within the grave shall rise as one great army, for Christ died all to save. So lift your heads, take courage, there'll come an end to sorrow, when Christ as King shall then reign o'er the blessed world of tomorrow.
You probably recognize one of our dear brethren paraphrased that quotation in the first volume about close your eyes for a moment. Well, brethren, there's some other wonderful scriptures about that, the blessings of that kingdom. We ask Sister Rhonda Phillips to read this next passage.
None shall say, and he shall judge among many people, and rebuke strong nations afar off. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree, and none shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts hath spoken it. Micah 4:3-4. Violence shall no more be heard in thy land, nor wasting destruction within thy borders. Isaiah 60:18. And no inhabitant will say, I am sick. The people who live there will be forgiven their iniquity. Isaiah 33:24. For I will restore health to you, and your wounds I will heal, says the Lord, because they have called you an outcast. It is Zion. No one cares for her. Jeremiah 30:17.
Yeah, brethren, again, these are wonderful promises. Sometimes why it's an expression of what will not be here in the earth any longer. But brethren, if you want to read a passage about praise in the kingdom, there's nothing better than Psalm 145. And we've asked here Sister Deborah Ball for this reading. And notice how one generation, as each one comes back, how they'll speak to each other.
One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power, to make known to the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord upholds all that fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all wait upon you, and you give them their meat in due season. You open your hands and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Psalms 145:4-11-16.
Friends, just as an example of this one generation speaking to another, think of the generation that built the Tower of Babel and were stopped, and how they'll be able to speak to the modern generation that actually built skyscrapers. And they'll find out why that was put to a stop at that time. But you can imagine all the various generations, the lessons that they'll have from one another as they review history and they review what the Lord did in those various stages of human history. Probably one of the first scriptures I learned from the brethren was this one. The knowledge of the Lord shall cover the earth as the waters cover the sea, and none will need to say to his neighbor, know the Lord, for his ways will be made plain to all. Brethren, think about that as a desire of all nations, just everyone knowing their Heavenly Father and knowing Jesus who died for them, the author and the executor of God's plan. Now for our last reading, we've asked Brother Dick Pettimores to read a passage. I'll start with, O Death, Where Is Thy Sting?
O Death, where is thy sting? I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O Death, I will be your plagues. O grave, I will be your destruction. Pity shall be hid from mine eyes. Hosea 13:14. And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. Revelation 21:4-5.
Brother, when you write down this Revelation passage, please add verse 5. For these words are true and faithful. We want to hold on very tightly to these promises for mankind as we see the trouble in the earth. And brethren, we hope this is refreshing to you. We get deluged with bad news all the time. We need to really lay hold of the promises and keep them before our mind. The promises for the world as well as the ones that are personal for us. Well, dear brethren, we have one hymn to sing to close, and this is called The Savior of the World. This, I'm told, is a hymn that the Irish brethren used to sing at every convention they had. And it's a very familiar tune. It's the tune that we commonly call Danny Boy. It's actually a classical tune. But the words here are beautiful. We just ask you to notice the refrain of the verses, I cannot tell, and then the chorus, but this I know. I think you'll find a real blessing in this. The Savior of the World.